Well, a little bit of background. Actually, I belong to a National Guard unit in California, and we were one of the very few units that was activated, and we were activated in 1968. We went up to Fort Lewis, Washington. We trained up there for like 5 months. We were an armored cav unit. We had tanks and tracks. I was an 11 Charlie. I had a mortar platoon. I had a four-deuce mortar in the back of a track on a road march on the way back into Fort Lewis. One afternoon, it came over the radio that the unit from California that was activated was not going to be sent as a unit to Vietnam, and everybody was pretty happy about that. The next day, they started to levy or cherry pick the different MOSs, and 11 Charlies were the first batch they took. So that's what I happened to be, and about 30 days later, I was on a plane headed to Vietnam, didn't know a soul. I was there roughly 10 and a half months, and then they started kind of a withdrawal program, and I don't know why I was fortunate enough to be picked, but they took a bunch of us and they sent us to Hawaii. And everybody thought that that would be really good, but it was different. I mean, we were accustomed to doing our job in Vietnam, and we didn't have to. How can I best describe it? We didn't salute officers. We wore what was comfortable. We did our job. That was the main thing. You know, we did what we had to do. And once we got back to Hawaii, it was a different scenario altogether. It was back in the regular Army again, and it was hard to adjust to that. But anyway, we made the best of it, and about 2 months later, I was discharged and went back and got my wife and daughter, and we went back out to California for a year. You know, I don't know. I think when I first got back, I was kind of standoffish, even to my wife. I don't know why. When I was in Vietnam, I was in the Delta. I had a four-deuce platoon. We were usually out on a riverbank or in a small village, and there weren't many other U.S. troops around us. Sometimes there was a squad of riflemen. Other than that, it was pretty much just us, and there were some Marvin soldiers, but I look at my experience like this. I had it a lot worse than a lot of people, and I had it a lot better than a lot of people. So I like to think it didn't change me, but I'm sure it did in some way, and the older I get, the more sentimental I get. I think so. I didn't meet with all the protesters when I got off the plane. I guess maybe one of the reasons was I flew back into Minneapolis from Seattle, and we got in at like 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning because of weather, and there was myself and a lieutenant that had been discharged, and I think two other people, and we were the only ones on the plane other than a bunch of I think it was Northwest Orient at the time, and they were shuttling crews back that had been stranded in Seattle just like we had. So maybe that's why I didn't see it, but I never experienced that, which was a good thing because I don't think I could handle it. It's brought a lot of soldiers together. We have a very, what's the word I'm looking for? We have a chapter of Vietnam veterans in Watertown and the surrounding area. We're like the 13th largest chapter in the United States. I mean, we have just about 500 members. We're very active. We do a lot to help veterans. Prior to this, our chapter is only like 6 years old, and prior to that, I didn't know anybody else that was a veteran, and now I have a lot of friends that otherwise I would not have had. And I never really experienced this either, but a lot of guys, when they came back, Some of the existing clubs did not want Vietnam veterans. I don't know what their feelings were, but that's just the way it was. And a lot of my brother soldiers here have said the same thing, that when they went back to their hometowns, the old school, I guess, for lack of a better term, they didn't want them. I guess I never really experienced that either, and I never joined a service organization until the Vietnam veterans came along. And I'm a charter member of our chapter, and quite proud of it. I drive the DAV van. I haul other soldiers down to the hospital in Sioux Falls. I've been to Minneapolis. I was on my way down there one day. I was hauling an older gentleman, and he said, do you belong to the VFW? And I said, no. He said, are you eligible? I said, yeah. He said, I'll pay your first year's dues. So that's how I got involved with the VFW. I also belong to the American Legion, not this particular post. I belong to the one in Marietta, Minnesota. It's a small post over there, and we have some members in that post also. And one of their members is very instrumental in our honor guard. We do funeral honors. So I thought I would support them in that endeavor. So we do a lot of good. We help a lot of veterans. We do funerals. We volunteer to do different things. We help veterans that need help in many different ways. Car payment, they might be short a house payment, just need money to get from one spot to another. We really do a lot at Christmas time. We help families and individuals both. Normally we give out food gift cards so that, you know, they have food for the holidays. We donate to the Salvation Army a couple times a year. We're a big supporter of them. They do a lot of good. They help veterans, but they help other folks too. And that's the reason we raise some of the money that we do, is so that we can help these people. Yeah, it definitely made a difference. I mean, the media played a big part while we were over there. I mean, you know, freedom of the press and everything else is all well and good, but they showed things that, to me, the media is still too involved with the military. If they just let us do our job, we'd have been done and out of there in no time at all. And the same thing is happening right now in Afghanistan. I mean, if the media would just kind of back out and the politicians would let the military do their job, they'd get it done in short order. But that's just not the way it is. I mean, it'll never change again. In my humble opinion, there should still be a draft. I think everybody should serve at least 1 year, either military or Peace Corps or some deal like that. I mean, it's a character builder. Our country's gotten way too soft. I'll just let it go with that. One of the things that President Johnson did was he signed a proclamation where basically they did not activate very many guard or reserve units. And what that did was it didn't put the communities behind the troops. Now the military relies on the reserves. And so, like, when they activate a unit like out of Watertown, for an example, the whole community comes together, because you know people that are going, where, you know, without the reserves in there, they'd take a guy from here, a guy from there, one from Haiti, one from Lake Norden, three from Watertown. There was no impact. The people didn't really realize it. The only time they felt that, you know, they had a loss or something was if one of the guys didn't come back, or if he came back maimed. And there were a lot of those, and there are now too. But with the community behind the units that are being activated, it just brings it a lot closer to home. One other thing, like, I was married and had a child when I went to Vietnam. And so I was a little bit older than most of the folks. You know, some of the career guys were older, but for the most part, you know, they were 19, 20. I was older when I was over there. I turned 25 in country. That was a little different. I missed my folks' 25th wedding anniversary. I missed my grandfather's funeral. I missed those things.